of celebration already. Hope you're in the spirit.
I want to mention that this is Holy Week. We are right on the precipice of it. Just so important to think deeply and to be very much in prayer and reflecting on the meaning of this week in the life of Jesus so many years ago. And also want to remind you that we have a Good Friday service at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. I hope you can come and join us on Good Friday. Edwin Toppin, a member of our church and one who has been a frequent speaker in our student ministries and always done a very fine job, will be speaking that evening. So please do come and join us. And then Easter Sunday is next Sunday. And if you come to this service, you're just going to adjust your time a little bit, aren't you? You're going to show up about 15 minutes earlier so that we'll just have a little bit more time in between, and that will help us on Easter Sunday. As we get started here, you've heard about Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Now, I want to share a couple of more verses about what Jesus did after he arrived in the holy city. I'm working in Matthew chapter 21 today, and I'll just read for you verses 12 and 13. It says, Jesus entered the temple and began to drive out all the people buying and selling animals for sacrifice. He knocked over the tables of the money changers and the chairs of those selling doves. He said to them, the scriptures declare my temple will be called a house of prayer, but you have turned it into a den of thieves. Well, as you already know, it's Palm Sunday, and next Sunday, Easter, is a day of such great and joyous and wonderful celebration in the life of the church. It was fun this morning, wasn't it, to wave those palm branches, whichever kind you had, and to welcome the kids and to celebrate with the kids, and the kids are always fun, aren't they? We love it when we get to see the children and get to be a part of their celebrations, too. You know that kids and palm branches were a big part of Palm Sunday when Jesus arrived in Jerusalem. But there was, of course, more to it than just that. Did you know that Jesus' arrival, I mean, what he did, how that all worked, sent important messages to friend and foe alike in the city of Jerusalem? You see, Jesus preached a powerful sermon just in the way he entered the city. We call it his triumphal entry, and it was power-packed with meaning. In fact, if we think about what Jews in the first century would have seen, we realize that Jesus was telling people a lot about his identity, who he was. He was telling people about his mission, what he had come to this world to do. And he was even signaling his priorities in the week to come. I want us to look into this carefully this morning. So first of all, let's say this. In allowing this parade-like atmosphere, Jesus was showing himself, first of all, to be a king. A real king. A different kind of king, to be sure. But there's no doubt in the minds of the people walking along that road with him, many of them from his home region of Galilee, that he was their king. And they had come with him to Jerusalem hoping to seize the throne, the authority, the leadership of Israel. And it's very clear throughout the gospel accounts of Jesus' life that Jesus knew the scriptures. He knew that riding on a donkey's colt would enable him to fulfill that great prophecy of Zechariah that we talked about, you know, the great king who comes to his capital city, to Jerusalem, riding on the back of a young donkey. And the fact that this was a colt that had never been ridden before just underlines the sacred purpose of what was going on here. But this is still not how most ancient kings would arrive in their capital city. Most of them would ride a horse, a symbol of power.
A donkey was what? A beast of burden. A work animal. You know, farmers used them to plow their fields and to thresh the grain. Traders used them to transport their goods to market. Oftentimes, people rode them rather than having to walk long distances in the hot sun. There was nothing rich or showy about a donkey. Lots of ordinary people were able to own one. But we also need to see that the donkey was a symbol of peace. The horse spoke of conquest, of domination. And isn't it true? Nobody would really want to ride a donkey into battle. I mean, they're not built for combat. When a king rode a donkey, it was his way of saying, I have come in peace, not with a sword. See, Jesus was sending a message by riding a donkey. He was saying, I'm not here to start a war. I won't be inciting political revolution, but I'm still a king, and I'm going to establish a kingdom. It just will not be limited to one nation. It will span the world, and it will be a kingdom of peace. Jesus' humility and his commitment to peace did not start with this ride into Jerusalem on the back of this young donkey. His ministry was saturated in it. We have sort of mixed feelings about humility, don't we? We like the idea, but at the same time, we're not sure it'll really get us anywhere in life. You know, it's one of those things where we say, yeah, some of it is okay, but too much of it, you might end up somebody's doormat. Isn't that right? The Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines humility as freedom from pride or arrogance. Oh, that is good. That's good. As far as it goes. But let's understand, in Matthew's gospel, this Greek word is often translated with the English word meek. Did you know that? Meek. That's not a word we use very much. Some people would even say meek means weak. But not in the Bible. And definitely not in the life of Jesus. What meek means is that you refuse to advance your agenda by force or raw power, even if you have power. It's the idea behind the third beatitude, which says, blessed are the humble, for they shall inherit the earth. It's why Jesus taught his followers to be servant leaders, not to be authority figures who tell people what to do, and as he said it, who lord it over people. But who serve and lead at the same time. Think about all the power Jesus had. You know, think about all this power to do miracles. I mean, it was impressive. How much of that power did he use? When the Jewish leaders were accusing him of blasphemy and accusing him of stirring up rebellion against the Roman Empire. How much of that power did he employ when the Roman soldiers were mocking him and beating him, and when they drove the nails through his hands and feet, and when they hoisted his cross into the earth? There's an old song. It's got a chorus in it that goes like this. Some of you will remember it. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have. And then it goes on to say, he could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. So let's just pause for a moment to ask ourselves, how do I get things done? At home or at work, when there are people who answer to you, how do you get them to do the things that are important? Do you threaten them? Do you pressure them? Do you play the authority card? I'm in charge here. You have to do this. Or do you do it like Jesus? And call them to work alongside you. Do you model what it looks like to cooperate rather than to pressure or manipulate?
Sometimes we sing a Graham Kendrick song. It's an especially powerful song, and it goes like this. Meekness and majesty, manhood and deity in perfect harmony, the man who is God, Lord of eternity, dwells in humanity, kneels in humility, and washes our feet. Oh, what a mystery. Meekness and majesty. And then it says, bow down and worship. This is your God. That nails it, doesn't it?
Amen.
Meekness and majesty. Let's move on. In the way he entered Jerusalem, Jesus was showing himself to be a deliverer, a rescuer. This crowd. And Matthew says it's more the crowd that was with Jesus than the people of Jerusalem. This crowd showed their respect for Jesus by laying down their cloaks, first on the donkey's back, and then, you know, when there were plenty of them there, then they put them in the road in front of Jesus, and they laid down palm branches that they cut, all as a way of showing respect, of showing honor for the great leader, the great king, the deliverer who had come. And we have to acknowledge that Jesus allowed all of this, knowing it was appropriate and knowing at the same time he would have to disappoint an awful lot of these hopes during the coming week. They shouted blessings on the Son of David, Hosanna. This was all messianic stuff. I mean, they were welcoming the king that they believed Israel had been waiting for centuries and decades on top of centuries. The one who was going to rescue them from domination and oppression, and now he was arriving in the capital right in front of their very eyes. Israel as a free nation had been at the peak of its prosperity when who was king? David. And they recalled with such great longing the days of David. Oh, if they could just have a king like David again. And here he was. So they were shouting, Son of David, Messiah. Having healed so many people and taught with such authority about God and invited people into his new kingdom of faith and forgiveness, the crowds accompanying him on that road thought he had come to their capital city to confront the Romans. His disciples thought that. They knew that the kind of peace he talked about was the kind that you establish after you overthrow the oppressor. They didn't get that he was talking about a different kind of kingdom altogether, a kingdom that would never be limited to just one nation. Israel itself would never be enough for this kingdom. It would not dominate, but transcend, include, involve all the nations. But they were right about part of his mission. He did come to deliver his people. He did come to set people free. He did come to call them to leave behind their kingdoms of darkness where slavery to sin prevailed and to come into the kingdom of his light and his truth where there is freedom from sin and its deathly consequences. What the crowds didn't understand is that to establish his kingdom of love and truth would require his own death on a Roman cross. Jesus alone, in real time, on that Sunday so long ago, understood God's bigger story that he was a part of. The bigger story that starts out with the fact that human beings were created, all of us, to live in an eternal relationship with God. But we sinned. We traded that in. We turned our backs on him. We rejected our Creator's place at the center of our lives and the only one who is worthy of our worship. Sin is the word the Bible uses to speak of that rejection of God. And God established that the wages of sin is death. and death in the form of mortality became the destiny of every human being. And with death came eternal separation from God. But God was not about to let death and eternal separation from Him be the final verdict with these human beings He had created and He loved so deeply. At the right time, He sent His own Son, a member of His own threefold existence, to do for us what we could not do for ourselves, to actually live a sinless life. And what did Jesus get for that? He was rejected by us, the very people He came to save. He was rewarded with accusations of sedition and put on a cross. But God Almighty was still at work. He gave His Son's meaning, His Son's death, a deep meaning beyond anything anybody could have imagined. Jesus took upon Himself the penalty for our sins so that we could be rescued from eternal estrangement from God. And instead, He brought us back into eternal fellowship with God, so that no matter what sins we have committed, and we have all committed them, haven't we? The Bible says all have sinned, all, and fallen short of the glory of God. God's not counting them. He restores us to Himself and frees us from this death grip that sin holds on our lives. He gives us real power through His Holy Spirit to live a life that honors Him. I know this might sound like a complicated story with lots of moving parts, but really it's quite simple. The slow and painful death of Jesus on that cross is a reminder of how excruciatingly difficult it was for Him to rescue us. The crowds were right to welcome Him as their deliverer. They just had no idea how complete, how big, how full His rescue would be. They had no idea about the kind of kingdom He was going to establish through His death. They were clueless, even though they were right to cheer Him on. And here's one more. It's in what Jesus did next. He showed Himself to be a reformer. One of the first things Jesus did when He arrived in Jerusalem was to go where? Where'd He go? He went to the temple. You know something? Given His identity and His mission, it makes total sense that He went first to the temple. The temple was the center for the worship of God throughout Israel, wasn't it? I mean, there was no other place that was authorized for sacrifices to God. But we learned that Jesus had issues with the way the temple was being run. I think He probably had those issues for quite some time. And now He decided it was His opportunity to do something about it. Remember, Jerusalem was an urban center. Lots of folks who lived there didn't raise animals. They had to buy their sacrifices when they went to worship. And those who came from long distances, once, twice, three times a year, they weren't going to bring their animals with them. They had to buy their sacrifices at the temple too. There's only one place you could get them. I mean, the ones that passed inspection, that were good enough to offer to the Lord, that was inside the temple grounds. And yet the prices they were paying, and there are other historical documents that attest to this, were exorbitant. Two times, three times what you would pay on the streets of Jerusalem for that animal if your plan was to eventually eat it. Now, what does that remind you of? What does that sound like? Kind of makes me think about, you know, what you face when you go to a Mariners game or a Seahawks game. You say to yourself, I'm hungry. I think I'll go see what they've got at the concession stand. I think I'll grab a burger. Well, that's before the game. Man, you wouldn't say that. But answer me this question. What kind of prices do you face there at Safeco Field? At the clinic. Is it more or less than you would pay for that same burger Kid Valley. What is it, more or less?
More.
It's a lot more, isn't it? A lot more. Here's my advice. Eat before you go to the game. See, if you went to worship God and you didn't have with you an animal or a bird that could pass inspection, guess what? You had to buy one at the temple. And then you paid double or triple what it was worth. And of course, think about this for a second. To get permission to sell within the temple grounds, you had to get the blessing of the chief priests and agree to give some of your profit, not to them personally, but to the temple. It's a massive fundraising scheme. What a contrast that tiny little profit-making system was with the vision for the temple laid out by the prophet Isaiah, who said the temple was to be a place of what? Prayer. Listen to Isaiah 56, verse 7. I will bring them to my holy mountain of Jerusalem and will fill them with joy in my house of prayer. I will accept their burnt offerings and sacrifices because my temple will be called a house of prayer for all nations. Now think about this for a minute. When Israel was a free nation and the king ruled over the temple, right? That's what happened because Israel was a theocracy. What does that mean? Well, that means that civil government and spiritual life were fused together and represented in the king. Jesus was showing his legitimacy as king, wasn't he? By going to the temple and trying to rid it of corruption. He was saying, this temple belongs to me. Now, of course, he knew its days were numbered. He knew its animal sacrifices would soon be obsolete because his own body would be the final sacrifice, offered not on an altar within the temple grounds, but on a Roman cross just outside the city. And then, indeed, the temple, for however long it remained, would have no other purpose than to be a place of prayer. And as Isaiah said, for all the nations. You see, even worship in Israel was being completely redefined, reformed by Jesus. And I just want to know this. Have you let your life be delivered and reformed by Jesus, the King? That's why he came. Let's pray together. God, as we enter into this, what we call Holy Week, meaning a week when we recall and relive and remember those marvelous events of that final week in Jesus' life in terms of his journey, his sojourn through this world. Speak to us in some new ways. Let us again recognize and appreciate how important your deliverance is. That it truly takes us from darkness into light, from death into life. That it restores everything that was lost in Eden and has been lost so many times by each one of us over the years. Speak to our hearts in some new ways this year. Help us to see again just how amazing, how good, how loving you are. That you should seek us out by sending your own Son, that he should be so willing to lay down his life on a cross, when certainly he had the power to make that whole story end a lot differently, but he refused to do it. Because he knew this was the only way to pay our penalty for sin and to rescue us from its terrible eternal damages. We thank you and we give you